Well, I want to thank Liz for the opportunity to come to Seattle and see some moisture. We've been dealing with some dry conditions in the western part of the Great Plains. My goal today is, as Liz mentioned, to talk about livestock grazing in this changing climate. I want to thank Laura for setting up the nice examples with the National Climate Assessment, the projections ahead in terms of the climate variability and some of the directional trends that we may be embracing here. And I'll let B. Van Horn, who's following me on the slate here, talk about the climate hubs. I'm the director of the Northern Plains. And if you looked at some of those climate change projections, the Northern Plains appears to be the winner, if you will, in terms of increasing temperatures, greater productivity, and perhaps a shift in agricultural production towards the Northern Plains. So we're happy to see that. I do want to start off with some sideboards here in terms of, I think, why it's relevant for livestock grazing related to changing climate. We've got a global population that's expected, predicted to increase to 9+ billion by mid-century. A lot of this growth in tropical environments in terms of population increase and a tremendous increase in animal protein demand, not only from the increase in numbers of population, but a rising middle class in India and China and many other nations. So we've got a challenge ahead in front of us, but also an opportunity. Laura mentioned this increase in greenhouse gases and the clear directional trends from the Industrial Revolution to current times and predicted ahead in terms of carbon dioxide for one. So it's 280 parts per million at Industrial Revolution. Currently about 400 parts per million, projected to increase to 550 by the end of the century. There's clear positive benefits for rangeland plants and many species in general in terms of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere increasing plant water use efficiency, and therefore we can produce more biomass per unit water. So that appears to be a very beneficial thing. However, in a lot of the field experiments we've been undertaking, that saved water, right, so that water is not being used by these plants, is being used by something else. Weeds, invasive plants, trees, or deep-rooted shrubs, such that we then see a shift in plant communities. So when it became much more problematic in terms of weeds or invasive species as we project into the future. And as Laura mentioned in some of the nice work, Jack Morgan, Daniel Mulchunas, and Shortgrass Step, and now we're seeing in Northern Plains more forage production, but less forage quality. So the increase in carbon in the atmosphere combined with a very stable amount of nitrogen in the soil creates higher carbon to nitrogen ratios in that forage quality, and therefore a decrease in that sort of forage quality for livestock performance. And as Laura again mentioned, these warmer temperatures and longer growing seasons have impacts in terms of wildfires, and we're already seeing that in parts of the Great Plains this year. Very anomalous type conditions, very dry for March, very warm, windy, and so we're now seeing large amounts of acreages under fire in those areas, and pest abundance. For example, we've already seen decimation of the pine forest in the Rocky Mountains because of the mountain pine beetle. And we see that sort of projections for future climates as well. And then the more extreme events, and Laura touched on this, so deluges, downpours, these very extreme precipitation events, but also concurrent with that is projections for longer, more intense, more severe droughts, and how that impacts livestock performance in a negative way, and the increase in heat stress. So with that as sideboards, here's today's path I'll outline, and we'll cut the talk down a little bit so we make sure we have time for B and others. But I want to take a quick look back in the 20th century and have a little bit of knowledge of what happened in terms of major droughts. A recent look at some of the droughts, especially in Texas, southern parts of the Great Plains. But the bulk of the talk would be on adaptive management. So how do we manage in this variable climate and take advantage of it and be opportunistic in terms of how we can be proactive? We still have some reactive strategies. And then how do we take spatial and temporal aspects into key when we look at livestock management? So we look back to the 20th century. Here's some key droughts, but I want to first focus on the upper left drought. So this is a Palmer's drought severity index encapsulating about 100 years. And the darker red colors there indicate when those areas of the nation are in drought 15 to 20% of the time, severe to extreme droughts. So these are bad ones. If you're in the black, you're in 20% of the time, so you're in tough conditions. But drought, as we see in this map from the western U.S., we have a long established history of dealing with drought. All right? We see some of the major droughts, and I just picked out three of them from the 20th century. 1988, tremendous amount of drought in the northern Great Plains, extended over the Pacific Northwest, East Coast. Largely the only area that wasn't impacted by drought then was the desert Southwest. 1956, the heartland of the U.S. took a tremendous amount of drought with the 50s drought, Texas all the way up through the Great Plains. the two coasts largely spared there. If you read the book Elmer Kelton, A Time It Never Rained, deals with the drought in Texas and the social, ecological, and the human dimensions aspect of that drought. Very nice book to read. And then, of course, the classic drought, so 1930s. So 1934, the worst drought on record. The entire U.S. mired in a drought. Substantial amount of soil erosion. Right, we're seeing deposition of that soil moved all the way to the East Coast. And again, a nice book, Timothy Egan's The Worst Hard Time, really going through the social human dimensions of how people dealt with that. And you see the classic movement of people from the Great Plains to California and the West Coast. So we have a history of that. That's gone on and continued in the early 21st century. We've got the ongoing four-year drought now in California, clearly impacting livestock industry. Here's a map in the upper left, number A. There is a snapshot of the 2012 flash drought. Caught a lot of us by surprise. Very quick coming drought, came with very hot temperatures. The darker reds and purples there are where we have severe and extreme drought. B, the panel, is all the counties in 2012 that were declared a drought disaster county by the Secretary of Ag. Again, looks like 1934, largely an expansion in the entire U.S., so a really pronounced widespread drought. And then I'm going to pick on Texas here when you showcase in 2011. They've dealt with drought through the late 2000s into early 2010s. Entire state was largely in a severe drought in 2011. All kinds of wind erosion, movement of soil, and it transformed the livestock industry. So we saw a large amount of beef cattle move out of Texas because of the long-term drought nature. Those cattle moved north into the northern Great Plains, Nebraska, South, and North Dakota, Montana. We saw feedlot capacity decline in Texas and shift north into Nebraska and South Dakota. Nebraska is now the number one feedlot state in terms of feeding capacity in the nation. And we saw livestock industry change as well regarding the packing or slaughterhouse capacity, where they were shut down in parts of Texas and those again moving north into the northern Great Plains. So fundamental changes associated with drought in terms of livestock capacity here. So here's a fundamental question if you're a livestock producer is, my goodness, how do you deal with this sort of change, variability on the landscape, and be flexible? So fundamentally, when you deal with situations when you have very high variability in forage production there on the y-axis across time, this is some data from north central Colorado, but it could be anywhere in the western U.S. We see this sort of temporal variation in forage production. It's very difficult if you're a rancher to match that forage production to your animal numbers on hand. So an example that I've highlighted, 2008, very low forage production. So you have very low animals, you probably sold animals off. But then the next year you have a sevenfold increase in 2009 in available forage capacity. What do you do with that? How do you rapidly transform your livestock industry at your ranch or your operation to take advantage of that? And then just as soon as you ramp up, guess what? The drought hits again. 2011, 2012, we're at very minimal forage production. 2014, we're back up to very high. So this is a roller coaster we're riding here in terms of forage production. And I'm going to showcase some strategies where perhaps producers can be very opportunistic and how they take advantage of this and see as a positive rather than as a negative. So adaptive management comes into play here. And what's that really mean? Well, hey, here I think are three bullets that encapsulate to me the value of adaptive management. Make those adjustments when necessary, right? So that means there has to be some planning, some information. It's not see the pants, it's not reactive. Second of all kinds of knowledge is out there. Experimental, as Laura and others have showcased, there's a lot of information, but there's a lot of experiential knowledge out there. There's a lot of multi-generational ranching families on the landscape. What have they done? How have they been out there? How are they resilient to the changes? And then I think we need to take the opposite approach and embrace that spatial and temporal variability, right? See it as a positive than rather as a negative, something we're continually fighting against. And we'll showcase some strategies on how that's done. 2012, I had a postdoc and we sampled over 300 ranchers in Wyoming. Historically, you know, lots of drought in that system. And we asked them several questions related to their operations, several related to drought. And we came up, I think, with a nice figure here that encapsulates how those ranchers are proactive in dealing with drought, and those are in the blue, and how they respond or reactive in the red in terms of the drought management strategies. What I'd like to do is quickly cover their proactive and their reactive strategies here. So being proactive, a couple key categories. One, they told us that they have a reserve forage supply. All right, so they have something, quote, in the bank. They're stocking conservatively, 48% of them. So about half of them are stocking below probably the capacity because they know they've got this bouncing around in forage production. They're resting pastures for plant community composition enhancement, but also for forage reserve. And they're utilizing grass bank capacity when they have that, either from perhaps environmental conservation groups or other entities that have some land that they can utilize during drought conditions. They're also trying to vary their stocking rate with the forage supply. And they're doing this a couple different ways. About a quarter of them, a little over, are incorporating yearlings. Right? So that's the flexibility. That's the ebb and flow in their livestock enterprise. Only about 16% are using weather predictions to adjust their stocking rate, so trying to look ahead. Here's, I think, although it's limited in use, here's a lot of potential for the system. What can we utilize in terms of the NOAA 1, 3, and 6 month predictions? And if we can enhance the capability, the robustness of those give us an amazing tool to look into the short-term future and make management decisions and reduce risk in terms of how we match animal demand with that forage supply. Now the classics on the right-hand side, the drought response. What happens when the drought hits and we wait and then we make those management decisions? 80% reduce the herd size, right? You're limited in forage supply, you gotta get animals down, so that means moving, selling animals. You wean calves early, half of them are doing that to getting that calf off of that cow to reduce her forage demand. They're getting that calf off of the range land and into some sort of feed supply. And those that have yearlings are largely selling them because 24% are doing that. Either that or we're trying to increase the forage supply. So it's drought condition, what do? We're trying to buy feed. That's great. Everybody in this room's in the drought. We're trying to buy feed. Guess what? If you're selling feed, that's the time to be the more forage supply and forage demand. You're trying to rent additional pasture. Well, if everybody's in a drought and there's limited forage available, again, forage is going to be high in terms of rents. 27% told us they're moving livestock to another location. Again, here's, I think, a fundamental change in the livestock enterprise we've seen. We're now moving cattle around on the regions and across the U.S. in a much more transformational way. You saw that in the drought of Texas, those cattle moving north and staying north. You're seeing cattle from California now moving out of California and staying out of California. So we're now a much more mobile society in terms of livestock movement. We can put them on a truck, ship them. It's a lot quicker, it's a lot easier, and costs a lot less than trying to move feed back to those animals. And we're placing livestock in a feedlot in certain circumstances. And clearly the drought impacts there on the bottom of the slide, these are fundamental, right? So you're reducing grazing capacity, profitability declines, winter feed availability is declined. So now you're in a situation where you need to buy feed, and as Laura indicated, irrigation water is down, calf weaning weights, livestock reproduction rates are down. All negative things dealing with drought. So to combat that, let's look at planning. Interestingly, out of this survey, again, of over 300 ranchers in the Wyoming, and we also did it in California, very similar responses in a separate study. To me, it was encouraging. 60% of them told us they have a drought management plan. Now, we didn't ask specifics on when that was written down, if it had been actually, you know, worked with some sort of professional, but they have a plan, either in their head, but they have something. That to me is encouraging. The problem is, that means we still have 10 or 40% of producers managing by the seat of the pants. So there's a lot of capacity in the system here to take those 40% of ranchers and get them to encourage to put something down on paper. It's much easier to look at that plan in terms of triggers, takes a lot of the stress, a lot of the pressure off, and how they respond to drought. And in dealing with a question towards future climate change and droughts, 40% of producers thought that drought's gonna be more influential in their management in the future than it had been in the past. Now, this could also be a little bit confounded by our survey in 2012 had followed up a series of drought years in the 2000s. Now, that had been predicated though by the 1980s and 1990s largely being wetter than average. So there, I think there's some experiential knowledge gaps there, perhaps in some of those producers that may have got caught in the early 2000s with some drought management plans because of the wet years. Oops, here we go. Interestingly, we also asked these producers, if you have and want to write comments, please provide those to us in terms of your drought management. And we had some really nice responses out of these producers, and I thought I'd share some of those from you on the ground type experiences. So drought planning or preparing here, one of these nice producers said, yeah, we've got a plan. It's kind of a pessimistic plan, right? It's going to happen. We really can't do anything about it. But they're doing things in a way that they're conservative because they know it's going to happen. They're not sure when, but they'll be ready for it because when it comes, it just won't hit us as hard as it might hit somebody else, right? So it's one of those, maybe I'll lose a little bit. Everybody else will lose a little bit more. We'll stagger through it and wait for the good times to return. That's why we run a smaller cow herd, and that's why we're kind of understocked. So we're not pushing the system to the limit, because when that happens and we have drought, then we have a tremendous economic impact and we have some management decisions that are tough to make. Another one I thought was interesting said, hey, here's an opportunity. We've been doing business as usual. Drought whacks us alongside the head and says, wait a minute, here's our chance to make a change that we might not ordinarily do. All right, we might be stuck in a rut because grandpa did it this way, dad did it this way, we're still doing it this way. Here's an opportunity sign because of drought. Clearly, economics plays a role in this because, as he says in here, I've underlined for expression here, expensive education do something different, right? You keep doing the same thing time after time, we're going to get the same sort of results. Here's a chance to do something change. I like the fact that this person said, you went through the last drought and didn't do something before this next one is crazy. People are doing something. We're seeing on the landscape that people are responding to drought and making fundamental changes. And how are they doing that? Well, they're incorporating flexibility. And so we saw from that survey about 28% of our producers in Wyoming were using yearlings, at least in the 2012 survey. This producer really, I think, drives it home that if you have a diverse type of livestock enterprise, so you've got something, a cow-calf plus, in this case, a yearling enterprise, you have options to destock. It's much easier to do when you have a drought, especially when it's an abrupt drought like 2012, where it's flash. It comes on in a very short time period. You've got a diverse group of cattle. You've got some assets that are readily marketable. You don't have to drive right away into decision-making related to selling that core base genetic herd that you've worked your lifetime to have matching in terms of your genetics to your environment. Yearlings are a lot easier to load. You're just not attached to them. Right? It's easy to call the truck, boom, here they come, load them, and off they go. So in this case, you've got flexibility in decision making, and you're able to maintain that base cow herd because you reduce that to some lower sustainable number. So how do you deal with this temporal variation? We showed that graph where it's, my goodness, up and down, and really no pattern to it. Well, some of those producers that we've seen are very conservative in their stocking rates. They're planning for those poor events. And they're not gonna be as, they will make as much money in the good years, but they'll save that grass and have it available for the drought years. And we see entities trying to use grass banking or forage reserves as an opportunity to have those animals move when we have drought conditions. How do we match animals with forage production, forage availability? Because this is the key fundamental thing. It's easy to sit here and say, yeah, just add, subtract, make it easy. But fundamentally on the ranching enterprise, on landscape, this is a difficult decision-making thing. And you have to be proactive to develop that sort of capacity, right? You have to be thinking ahead of the game. What's my strategy going to be? Where am I going to obtain those animals? Right? Where am I going to remove them and where to? Right? Because there's a lot of economics involved here, and there has to be some sort of herd health issues. Right? What am I going to be bringing in? What am I going to be shipping out? How can I add forage quickly? Do I have some sort of strategy involved? If it starts to become dry, I see key indicators, I have some triggers, and it's starting to dry up, maybe I've got capacity to leave some additional ground. Let's get on it and move quickly before others get there. Maybe I buy some feed on the cheap, right? Before prices start to increase, so I've got some resiliency in my system. And I think one of the things we're starting to see is this regional risk reduction. Drought's not being localized, but much more expansive. So how do I deal with a drought in a larger regional context? All right, do we have some sort of way, if we're large enough and we have enough land base, to buy additional ranches in different parts of the country? And then we know that certain one may have a drought, we move cattle from X to Y, move them back and forth, so we've spread a risk spatially that way. do we have some cooperation among different sorts of producers, that almost a reciprocal agreement that if it's dry at my place, perhaps I can ship you some cattle, and when it's dry at your place, perhaps some, your cattle can come to my place? Is there a way with information technology the way it is now to share that sort of information and really allow producers to reduce the risk because you're moving cattle on the landscape in a spatial manner? And then how do we understand other sources of variability, right, in terms of soils and topography? I'll showcase in the next slide some of that inherent variability, but it's much more apparent in the western part of the U.S. than it is in the Great Plains, because you've got topography dealing with. So where is it going to be wet? Where is it going to be dry? How productive are your soils? That sort of inherent knowledge base is really informational when you're looking at moving cattle around on the landscape and what sort of drought resiliency you have in your operations. And again, rainfall. We know that everybody's going to get on average 13 or 14 inches of rain, right? How do you encompass that sort of variability and take advantage of that to be a proactive manager? Some nice work. David Augustine on my staff there in Cheyenne, Fort Collins, took some historical data off the eastern part of Colorado here, and we explicitly chose that because we have limited influence of small-scale spatial variability in topography. It's largely just due to the Rocky Mountains there on the west side of the state influencing the western Great Plains here. And you take that section of the state and you take the historical records on B there, the darker figures indicate drier long-term annual precipitation, and the whiter it gets, the more precipitation you get. So you can see in the northern part of Colorado there, you have a drier to increasing or wetter environment as you move across the state. That's fundamental knowledge you need to know as a producer in terms of, okay, that makes sense in terms of where I might have less or more risk. That's the long-term average. We showcased 2002 and C. That was a very dry year. So you see those sort of circles and darkness increase. And 2003, a wetter year. So you see some spatial changes on that. That's information that's widely available now to producers on where the precipitation's fallen and where you can minimize, again, this drought resistance, drought risk in terms of where you might need to move cattle on the landscape. And this, again, pretty small scale, just a part of the state. I'll wrap up kind of with the so what, who cares, right? So this is easy to talk to producers and say, we should be increasing flexibility. It makes sense, fundamentally makes a lot of sense in terms of operations. But boy, when you can distill it down in terms of dollar figures, it really hits home. So a nice work, Alan Terrell, who's down in New Mexico State, put together an average ranch in northern New Mexico and basically said, listen, we've got four scenarios that we could run on this ranch. We have stocking rate. We could be very conservative as we showcase some of the producers do that. Or we could try to really push the envelope and be flexible. Within the conservative stocking rate, we're going to be only cows and calves, or we're going to have cows and calves with some yearlings, same sort of thing if we're flexible. So four management scenarios here, indicating how flexible we can be, with the caveat that we're assuming that NOAA and others could give us very high quality precipitation forecast, good robustness, something we could rely on. And he took this ranch and ran it for 30 years, and if you're conservative stocking with forage only to cow calf, you didn't purchase any yearlings. Over those 30 years, your net return on this average ranch in New Mexico was $55,000. Pretty nice income over that 30 years. If you just added yearlings and stayed conservative in your stocking, didn't do any fundamental change, or just added yearlings, over those 30 years, approximately half the time you would buy yearlings because of the increase in forage supply. Over those 30 years, on average, you would increase by about $8,000 your average return. $8,000 times 30 years, do the math, $240,000, a lot of dollars. So that's just one simple fundamental change that drives home some nice economics, 14% return. Now let's make the contrast. We're going to ramp up management. We're going to be as flexible as we can to match forage production with animals. We're going to stay only cow-calf, so we're never going to buy yearlings. On average, $69,000 net return, $14,000 compared to conservative, just by being able to match forage supply with forage demand from those animals. Again, the caveat being here, we have to have those robust precipitation forecasts so that we can manage our risk. If we really take it to extreme and we take the adaptive management approach to the nth degree, we're flexible in our stocking, we have cow calves, we're adding a yearling enterprise into it. About half the time we're going to buy yearlings again because of the way the precipitation forecast came out over those 30-year forecasts. $115,000 annual net return. Contrast that with conservative cow-calf, that's a $60,000 increase. You've doubled your economic returns by doing nothing. You're not increasing the amount of land, you're not doing anything else to your operation, but fundamentally matching your management in terms of being very proactive and very flexible here. Take this sort of money and multiply it by 30 years, and there's a lot of returns that are sitting on the table, I think, for a lot of producers out there. Right? Again, the caveat is we need those high precipitation quality forecasts. I think they're becoming better. They're still difficult in many regions of the U.S. because of mountain influences and so forth. But if this sort of thing comes to fruition, I can see a lot of producers seeing this bottom line and taking advantage of it. With that, Liz, hopefully I've left a little bit of time for questions, and then also to hopefully get us back on time for scheduling. Question?
Is there any work being done in terms of management besides like variations in what kind of animals you're stocking with? About, you know, heavily grazing and heavily rotating also. Like the land management being more high intensity with their land management and the high rest periods to help the soils. Is any management practice or any management practices being worked on with that?
Great question. So I'll repeat the question. Are there research being done in terms of different land management approach or grazing approaches in terms of longer rest periods?
Heavier grazing
with longer rest periods. So much more of a pulse-type grazing rather than traditional season-long or, I'll say, a shorter rotations. Yes, there's several of those. In fact, we've got a study that's co-production. We've got producers, we've got environmental groups, land management agencies doing that sort of experiment where we are comparing and contrasting against traditional season-long grazing with that fundamental approach to grazing of can we have very high grazing intensity for a short time period, but then a long extended rest, so a year plus, right? Trying to perhaps simulate some of the evolutionary history of grazing, but also to provide some capacity in the system to ensure that we have changes in grazing seasons over time and over year. What we're seeing is classic response. Once you increase or ramp up livestock density on a piece of ground and you move them around, you'll see decrease in livestock individual performance, right? You're forcing those animals to eat more species, less preferable. You're not having the selection ability, so their dietary intake is being reduced and their livestock gain is reduced. Now, when you scale that up, however, to a per unit area, you can either maintain or actually increase the amount of beef being produced per unit land area, and you can also perhaps increase the resiliency of the system because you've got some areas that have been either ungrazed or now are long-term rested that you can come back to in terms of flexibility or resiliency in the system. So that's going to, I think, going to work quite well on operations that have a larger land base that can do that. In fact, many of the large operators in our region are already doing something like that. They may not be ramping up the grazing intensity as much as they theoretically could, but they are being very proactive in moving grazing animals around on the landscape and moving grazing seasons, and then also trying to periodically rest pastures as a grass banking or forage supply basis. Right, I think those producers who continuously season-long graze at the maximum ability of their system and then hope and pray that this sort of roller coaster evens out, those are the ones mostly at risk for governmental assists when drought hits. Great, great question.
The
studies, unfortunately, are not long-term yet enough to show that. I think there are emerging trends that will happen, especially in our system of the Western Great Plains for cool season perennial grasses. which are highly desirable not only for forage production, but forage quality, as well as habitat structure. Right? So not only are we trying to produce beef, but we've also got a lot of other ecosystem services, habitat structure for either threatened and endangered species, such as sage, grouse, potentially lesser prairie chicken, and other grassland birds. So how do we manage that system, right, for diversity, heterogeneity? And I think these sorts of systems that embrace short-term high stocking densities but longer-term risk, I think our ability to manage systems in a much more heterogeneous way. So yeah, I think those positives, again, trying to blend and balance those, I think is really where the next step in where we need to go, and bring in economists, social scientists, and so forth. Thank you.